So what are your thoughts on the fact that all the primaries are kind of earlier and CPAC doesn't have a chance to really weigh in as much as it did before?
Yeah, interesting. Our primary is April 3rd. You know, running down ticket, you know, it has an effect. I'm in a blue state in Maryland. But, you know, I believe in ideas. I'm not a party guy. I say that all the time. I'm not a Republican first. I'm a conservative first. I'm a Republican as a method to get on a ballot to effectively run an effective campaign. But I'm a conservative. I'm a Republican because Republican values tend to espouse more of what I believe in right now. But the party label really doesn't mean anything. So, you know, we'll see. April 3rd is our primary. I'm not really concerned, but I think our message has really resonated across party lines quite a bit. And I think you'll see that in a lot of our volunteers. You know, we don't engage in any kind of, you know, racial kind of overtones in our campaign or anything like that, but that matters to some people. We have a very diverse campaign. We have a large group of people. We get out in all of these communities. We get out and talk about school choice, issues that matter to some minority and lower income communities. I mean, these are issues that matter to me. You know, I grew up extremely poor. I don't tell you that as a sympathy plea. You know, my poverty scars are what made me who I was, but you can't fake that. When you go into a lower-income community, authenticity is not something you can buy. And that's why we've attracted such a loyal following there. We've done really well. You'd be quite surprised.
I wouldn't be surprised at all. I think that's a great message. The truth is that the solutions, it's one of the mistakes that I think one of the presidential candidates made the other day, Romney, talking about he wasn't concerned about the poor, that and what he probably, what a lot of people have mentioned, and I would agree that he probably should have said, was the only way to uplift the poor is to support, you know, free markets. So if you had to pick, you know, one or two things that you as a freshman senator would work on day one, what do you think it would be?
We have got to fix the tax code. I just find it ironic that the president gave this speech about inequality, and yet the three things he could do to make the poor richer, because let's say it's two sides of the equation, right? The really rich and the really poor. Why are we worried about successful people getting more successful? Let's worry about the poor folks getting successful. Let's not make the rich poorer. What we could do is school choice, revamp the tax code so you don't have to have an army of lawyers and lobbyists to win. I mean, really, does that work for you? It doesn't work for my small business. I can't afford it. Schools, cronyism, and interest rates. We have 0% interest rates that are bankrupting our seniors. How does that, you know, you gave this speech on inequality and yet you foster policies that reinforce it. It's just it's an absurdity. And, you know, I'm calling it what it is. It was a hypocritical speech. You know, we could change this tomorrow. We have to make the poor successful, not successful folks poor. That's not capitalism. That's not.
Not even close, right? You're right. So just one last thing. What do you expect to get out of the conference this weekend and, you know, going back to your district, which isn't that far away, mind you, but, you know. It's right down the road.
I cheat every year. We're in Maryland, so, you know, it's not easy. If you miss CPAC in Maryland, that's kind of rough. A free exchange of ideas. You know, we don't pretend to have all the answers. We like to come here, and as in any economic system, free trade, well, free ideas, this exchange of information is the way you build on your ideas. You know, you build your library of information. It helps us a lot. I really like to hear from folks. We've been at it all morning. So a lot of back and forth on healthcare, economics, education policy. Helps a lot.
The liberal media tries to say that Barack Obama has the youth in vote wrapped up. It's in his corner. What do you think about the presence today of college students and high school students here compared to prior years?
Yeah, well, it's pretty substantial, and it goes back to our comment before about the difference between intentions and results. You know, you can go out on a college campus and give a wonderful speech about how we, you know, we're all going to live in a Pollyanna utopian world. The reality is these kids can't get jobs. You know, and at some point, you have to feed yourself. You know, there's a hierarchy of needs here. When you wake up in the morning, and you don't have a job and you can't actually feed yourself, you know, what do you care about a speech? I mean, all you're doing is talking then. Remember, results matter. It's time for action. Action on the budget, action on the economy, action on healthcare, and action on education. Enough with the speeches. We've had enough. And I think the youth, the college crowd, we have a lot of CRs, college Republicans, are starting to see that. They're on our campaign. We have 1,000 volunteers. At least 300 are between 18 and 25.
That's amazing, especially from Maryland and the very blue Democrat.
That me being a little younger, being 37 years old, and being able to relate. And you know, I had mentioned it before to Butch, you can't buy authenticity. You know, politicians spend millions of dollars on consultants to try to appear to be, look, I'm one of you, I'm one of the middle class. Well, that's the easiest $1 million I never spent. I am one of you. I didn't have to buy a consultant to do that. And I think that's where the groundswell support in our campaigns come from. People just say, I heard you on the radio, and I've never heard that before. I say, what, the truth? And they say, yeah, I think that's it. Like, they've never heard someone just speak plainly. You know, I have a leadership resume. I've got the academic background. You know, why is the Senate the most exclusive club in the world? Where did that come from? It doesn't excuse you from having to do your homework, but what's the exclusivity? You work for us. We don't work for you. It's absurd. I speak about it passionately because it's very upsetting to me where our country's gone and this bourgeoisie attitude we have.
Well, we've had the benefit of interviewing a number of senatorial candidates, and I can say what separates you from most is how little you actually talk about yourself and how much you actually talk about the issues. So that, I know from a constituent standpoint, that that is a refreshing point of view these days. So best of luck with your campaign, and thank you so much for the interview today.
It was an honor. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.